Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. We have a lot to cover this week because next week is Computex, the annual tech convention held in Taipei, Taiwan, with a focus on PC hardware, which is proceeding as a hybrid event this year, but many announcements are anticipated and quite a few have already leaked out. I'll go over what to expect, even if it makes me a little sad because I really like Taiwan and I haven't been able to visit since 2018. Speaking of which, one of my last videos there was three things I hate about Computex. And while the points I made in that video are still totally valid, I'm really looking forward to returning in 2022 so I can be reminded of all the things that I love about visiting Taipei, like soup dumplings and beef noodles and green onion pancakes. And I'm sure there's other stuff besides food, but it's almost lunchtime and I'm hungry. I better get through the tech news so I can eat.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by MSI's MPG Series Z590 motherboards, built for Intel 11th Gen Core processors. Whether you prefer the blacked out look of the Gaming Plus, the Wi-Fi 6E support of the Edge Wi-Fi, or the extra power for overclocking provided by the Z590 Force or the Carbon Wi-Fi, every board is packed with features like 2.5 gig LAN, 20 gigabit USB 3.2, Audio Boost 5, premium VRM cooling, and of course, PCI Express Gen 4 support with supplemental PCIe power. RGB2? Yes, RGB2. Click the sponsor link in the description for more on the MPG Z590 motherboards from MSI. So Computex kicks off on Tuesday, June 1st and ends on Saturday, June 5th. There's some limited on-site stuff taking place in Taipei and quite a few virtual or pre-recorded events too. Keynotes are lined up for all the big players. NVIDIA will get in and out quick with an early 10 p.m. Pacific time presentation on Monday, May 31st. NVIDIA always likes to go first during big industry events like this, but watch out! AMD CEO Lisa Su just totally scooped NVIDIA by scheduling her keynote right before NVIDIA at 7 p.m. Pacific time, also on Monday. But hold on, Lisa says Intel, we're going to shoot our load even earlier than that on Sunday, May 30th at 7 p.m. Pacific time. And hey, that's tonight. Computex is already upon us. As for what they'll announce, that remains to be seen, but it's a pretty safe bet that NVIDIA has GPU launches lined up for the long-rumored RTX 3080 Ti and RTX 3070 Ti, which will be announced during their keynote, presumably, with reviews going up June 2nd and June 9th, respectively, if said rumors prove to be correct. They'll probably talk about AI and autonomous vehicles and the Grace supercomputer too, and it's expected that their light hash rate RTX 3000 series GPU versions are also going to be a highlight. Not just for the RTX 3080 Ti and 3070 Ti that are launching, but also new variants of the RTX 3000 series GPUs, minus the RTX 3090, which is already a little too expensive for crypto miners. AMD will likely also be talking GPUs, as there have been many recent rumors swirling around their mid-range Radeon RX 6600 and 6600 XT. Expect desktop and mobile variants of these Navi 23-based units, since laptop OEMs like HP have recently touted RDNA2-based graphics in their upcoming Omen lineup that will likely be some form of Radeon 6000M mobile GPU. As for CPUs, if AMD talks about next-gen products based on Zen 4, it will likely be just to tease us, as those aren't expected until 2022. But there is a rumor that the current-gen Zen 3 Ryzen APUs, the 6-core 5600G and the 8-core 5700G, might be coming to retail soon, and the actual dates for that could be announced at Computex as well. These CPUs with integrated graphics are already on the market, but are only available to system integrators, so you'd have to buy a full PC to get one, which isn't what a lot of DIY builders want to do. Brett from UFD Tech reviewed the 5600G in a couple videos recently, and it keeps up with the 5600X quite well, even with a discrete RTX 3060 added, except in Valorant for some reason. So there could be a lot of interest in these chips from aspiring builders, given the ongoing graphics card shortage. And Intel's keynote, titled Innovation Unleashed, will be focused on their 10-nanometer products. Yet again. That includes their Xeon Scalable Server Platform, aka Sapphire Rapids, and their desktop lineup, codenamed Alder Lake S, which is expected to launch in late 2021. CEO Pat Gelsinger is slowly steering the Intel ship, or barge, or whatever it is, in a new direction, but that takes time, so while there's still plenty of skepticism warranted towards Intel based on their performance over the past 4+ years or so, there's also some hope that they are making moves to compete with AMD's Ryzen lineup more effectively once they turn that corner. Unfortunately, we still have another half year or so to wait for Intel's next-gen CPUs, but their DG2 graphics card could be right around the corner. It's said to compete with the best from AMD and NVIDIA, and DG2 was expected to launch in 2022, but there's a chance that they could be ahead of schedule, and we might even hear more about it at their keynote, which again is later today. Now, one thing that Intel might have up their sleeve, if a mysterious listing from their ARC database is any indication, is 10-nanometer 11th Gen Core Tiger Lake desktop CPUs. That's a mouthful, but the basic idea is that after they ported their 10 nanometer architecture to 14 nanometer for wide-scale production of the current 11th Gen Rocket Lake CPUs, like the 11900K, this is an 11500, but you get the point, they managed, maybe, to also get that 10 nanometer design to work with 10 nanometer fabrication, as was originally intended, and maybe they'll launch more chips over the summer for LGA1200 before Alder Lake S comes in Q4. It's hard to say though, because the ARC information keeps changing, and these B-listed SKUs, like the i9-11900KB, have been shown as both desktop and mobile devices. As of now, for example, it says that this product launched in Q2 of 2021 is part of the desktop vertical, but is made for the FCBGA1787 socket, which is a laptop BGA socket. It's pretty weird, to be honest, but let's see if Intel discusses this later today. Now, I mentioned that Nvidia is really, really expected to announce the 3080 Ti and 3070 Ti at Computex, and here's a quick rundown of examples why. All of these pictures of RTX 3080 Ti GPUs that have surfaced in the last week or two are a pretty good indication. We have, for example, the RTX 3080 Ti Supreme X from MSI, the EVGA For the Win 3 Ultra, several boxes of 3080 Ti Vulcans from Colorful. This is probably the same design as the RTX 3080 Vulcan with the LCD screen that I used in the Tower 100 build that I did a few months back. And we have a Galax Boomstar model that features anime boobies, which usually helps boost FPS or FAPS per second. There's a Founders Edition RTX 3080 Ti, of course, which looks exactly the same as the RTX 3080 Founders Edition, but with Ti added to the text, and WCCF Tech has some pics of MSI's RTX 3070 Ti's with a Ventus 3X and a Supreme X variant shown. Finally, Gigabyte's Oris Spain Twitter account attempted to tease their Vision cards while censoring the model number, but kind of forgot that this top box's 3080 Ti text, which is still peeking out a bit. Or maybe that was intentional, because leaks equal views and marketing. I've just realized I'm helping them do that. All right, let's move on to my new segment, which I am tentatively calling Crypto Corner, where I talk about cryptocurrency's impact on the PC hardware market. Nvidia's light hash rate GPUs fell flat when they first attempted to launch the RTX 3060 with the limitation in effect, but they're doing it for realsies this time, and across the entire RTX 3000 series, except, again, the RTX 3090. Each new version sports a new device ID so as not to be usable with the driver package that spoiled the party for the LHR 3060 the first time around, and Chinese website EXP Review got their hands on one to test. As reported by videocards.com, the Zotac RTX 3060 LHR Apocalypse GOC specifically. Results showed no changes to gaming or synthetic benchmark performance, and the Ethereum mining hash rate is indeed roughly halved versus a non-LHR 3060, sitting at 20 to 22 million hashes per second versus 40 plus. Note also that the hash rate was low right off the bat, instead of starting at 40-ish and then dropping to 20-ish like it did with the original RTX 3060. If miners do avoid these cards, it should mean more on store shelves for gamers. Crypto mining operations exist all over the world where cheap electricity is available, and across the pond in the UK, some miners discovered that you can't beat free when it comes to your power bill. The interesting part is that this illicit operation, which was running around 100 Bitcoin ASIC miners with stolen electricity, was uncovered when 50 warrants went out to investigate suspected cannabis farms, which have similar power draw and heat output signatures. I think the universe could have aligned this one just a little bit better though. What if they were actually mining Potcoin, or cannabis coin, or one of the other weed-related cryptocurrencies? Would the cops still have counted it as a weed bust? These are the real questions that people should be asking. Also, FYI, weed crypto exists. Now, the success of Bitcoin or any cryptocurrency is based on widespread acceptance of said currency as a viable means of storing value. And Bitcoin in particular could be getting a validity boost soon from Apple, if a job listing spotted this week is any indication. Apple is looking for a business development manager who has experience working with alternative payment providers such as digital wallets and cryptocurrency. Apple accepting Bitcoin would have a big impact on the crypto market as a whole, but if I know Apple, they'd probably rather create their own proprietary crypto variant that sideloads a miner along with an iTunes installation and requires an upgrade to the latest iPhone version to access your wallet. Man, it's really been going down. Now, the price of Bitcoin still hasn't recovered from the $20,000-ish dollar dip that it took that played out over the course of May, and as of Friday, it was hovering around the $35,000 mark. I can't think of a good segue here, so Bitcoin's power usage Butte, Montana. If you think the amount of power consumed by crypto mining is ridiculous, would it change your mind if more operations used renewable energy sources? What if a big crypto mining operation called Atlas Power in Montana was helping to fund a 1,600-acre, 700,000-panel utility-scale solar farm in order to power their data center so they can expand and mine with more GPUs? Yeah, it doesn't change my mind much either. All right, let's slip into a freshly laundered pair of tech briefs, shall we? AMD is working on next-gen CPU stuff, and Twitter leaker Executable Fix seems to have some info on the AM5 platform, the successor to current-gen AM4, and it will be LGA 1718 Land Grid Array. Check out my LGA versus PGA video if you don't know the difference, but LGA puts the pins on the motherboard rather than the CPU. And while it's not a huge deal or anything, it's very interesting to hear if true. XFi, as I've just nicknamed him, also said the platform will support DDR5, PCIe 4.0, and unsurprisingly, will have a new 600 series chipset. Kinda sucks that there's no PCIe 5, but they might be reserving that for high-end desktop and server platforms where the bandwidth boost... But they might be reserving that for the high-end desktop and server platforms where the bandwidth boost is more likely to be actually taken advantage of. Now, even further down AMD's roadmap than AM5, which would support rumored CPUs codenamed Raphael that are Zen 4 and 5 nanometer based and would retail as the Ryzen 7000 series, is the CPUs that would come after that. And we don't know very much about those. In fact, even this Raphael stuff is still very much in the rumor phase. But a newly rumored rumor is that there's a Ryzen 8000 series on the roadmap with CPUs that are codenamed Granite Ridge. These would be 3 nanometer Zen 5 based CPUs. There would also be an APU lineup too, along with it, called Strix Point, and that's all. Actually, these new code names sound like Intel's map based ones, which have gotten really confusing, to be honest. Stop that, AMD. Stick with artists. You do artists, NVIDIA does scientists and mathematicians and stuff, and Intel uses stuff you can find on a map. I can't handle crossover code names. The world is already confusing enough with what you've done with the chipsets. Here's another early Computex announcement for you. Marvell announced NVMe SSD controllers that can support PCIe 5.0. That's nice, because it would suck if PCIe 5.0 launched with no devices available that use that standard. There's an 8-channel and a 16-channel controller variant, though, and Marvell said they can hit 14 gigabytes per second sequential read speeds and 9 gigabytes per second sequential writes, with up to 2 million random read IOPS. That's a lot of f***ing IOPS. Joe, if you can bleep the f***ing there. Hopefully that's obvious, but... USB Type-C is nice, it's reversible and all, and now there's a version 2.1 of the plug that can provide up to 240 watts of power to connected devices. That's up from 100 watts previously, meaning it could power an entire desktop monitor or workstation or gaming laptop, as long as it's not too power hungry. Dubbed Extended Power Range, or EPR, you'll need a new cable to handle all that juice, so old cables will be designated standard power range. Note that the Type-C cable and plug standard is not the same as the USB version. USB 2.0 or 3.0 or 3.2 Gen 2 by 12 or whatever the heck they call it now determines your bandwidth. USB Type-C version 2.1 devices should arrive in the second half of 2021. Cooler Master has mastered cooling once again by creating the world's smallest vapor chamber cooler, measuring 200 micrometers tall or just a little thicker than a human hair. The design is intended for use in thin devices such as smartphones, tablets, and laptops, where heat pipes are just too bulky and space is at a premium. Cooler Master worked with tech manufacturer Murata to develop the vapor chamber design, but they are still building out manufacturing facilities, so these probably won't be available in retail products until 2022 or 2023. So there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And before I close out, I wanted to ask you all for some feedback. There's a lot of potential Computex announcements this week, and I could wait until next Sunday to cover them, or I could do a special update or two midweek. I'll post a straw poll down below, so let me know how interested you are and what you'd prefer. And while you're down there, feel free to leave me a comment, maybe browse the articles I talked about today, which are linked in the description. And you can do all those other things too, like clicking the like button if you enjoyed the video. Check out my store at paulshardware.net for a selection of excellent merchandise options, including my new beer sets with the bamboo coasters, and subscribe to my channel if you'd like to see more videos like this one in the future. Thanks again for watching, everyone, and we'll see you again soon.